Well, welcome everybody. I'm Rob Corcoran. I'm in Austin, Texas, and this morning I'm going to be chatting with two longtime colleagues, Matthew Freeman and Ebony Walden, two trainers and facilitators who are in Richmond, Virginia, and we have collaborated for many years on interracial dialogue, training, facilitation, and so forth. And we're going to talk a little bit this morning about dialogue in this current era of Black Lives Matter. So my first question really is to both of you. You know, the USA and the world seems to be sort of rising up against a history of oppression, of discrimination, against violence of people of color. And so in this context, what is the role of dialogue? Some people may say, well, we're tired of talk, we need action. As dialogue practitioners, as trainers, how do you respond to this challenge? I mean, and what are the conversations that need to take place in a constructive way, both in the US and maybe globally? And do you see any ways in which this is occurring? So this is a sort of broad question really about the role of dialogue in this current situation. So Ebony, would you like to jump in first?
Sure. So the funny thing is that most of our calls, so our emails and telephones have exploded kind of in response as people need trained facilitators to process. So the first thing folks are actually asking us for is dialogue, facilitating around dialogue, because their staff really need space just to process recent events. So we've done a number of both dialogue sessions and just creating space for people to process. And we've done that in two ways. One in which we did affinity groups, because we're seeing that Black folks or groups of color and white folks kind of need separate spaces because they're really processing this differently and in our different phrases and their racial justice, anti-racist journey, and to not create harm or frustration or extra burden emotionally on either groups, you know, we've done affinity groups, and we've just kind of created space for staff to say, who am I, what do I value, how do recent events relate to me, my experience and my work, and then as an organization, what does this bring up for us, and what are the opportunities for action? So the first step in any of our engagements has been, at least for the past couple of weeks, really just sitting with staff, with their emotions and their experience, and that being the cornerstone for asking the question, what is it that we might do together? Mm-hmm. So I think it's been a really good tool, and there's a number of ways to do that, and we've been able to hold that space.
That's really interesting what you say about sometimes the need for Black folks and white folks to have their own conversation. I mean, right now I've just been facilitating a dialogue with a predominantly white downtown church here in Richmond, overwhelmingly white. And there were a couple of Black folks who started off in the dialogue. And, you know, after a couple of sessions, they said, you know, we can't do this. You guys need to do this work. We're supportive of you. We'll meet you at the other end when you've done this. But we can't be part of that conversation right now. That's your own conversation. So I think
I think now more than ever, white folks are ready and willing to do their work. And I think both folks of color and have realized that there's a conversation that we may need to have down the line about mm-hmm. sort of engaging with one another, but y'all need to do your work. And there's also some work we need to do. We've all, mm-hmm. you know, we've been breathing the same air, drinking the same Kool-Aid about what's our work? How do we process the emotional burden? How do we process our own internalized racism and oppression in the ways that we've been burdened in this? And so I think just allowing that and saying we can do this work and there are times that we can come together, but that may be a different frame, conversation, question for that. So,
and Ebony, I like the metaphor that you used about education, about like folks of color or Black folks have a
Right, yeah.
Could you share that?
Yeah, absolutely. So what I've been finding just from our work in general over the past year, and definitely the past couple months, is there is a gap, right? And so I'm actually writing this piece, and it's called Please Mind the Gap. You know, when you get on the train, it's like, please mind the gap so you don't fall or trip in that space. And I think both from a knowledge and experiential wise with racism, not all, but some Black folks are on like and masters and PhDs in understanding racism, right? And the myriad of ways that it shows up in the world, and some, not all, white folks are really in kindergarten. They're on the ABCs and 1, 2, 3s, right? So we're not, so we have to mind that gap. That's really the work. Until we we can't really have a deep conversation until we really mind that gap and get us all on the same page. I think that's when we can have a productive conversation. But right now, it's a huge gap. I was just writing something. All of the New York Times bestseller lists for nonfiction are books on race, racism, and white privilege. Like all of the top 15. And so I think white folks have been responding with what to do, how can we learn? And so there is that gap, but they also need to figure out what are the ways in which they can take that learning and turn it into action in their communities and at their organizations. And then how we can do that work together.
Matthew, what's your take on the role of dialogue right now?
Yeah, so I think that dialogue is often pitted against action. So like you said, people say, we don't need to talk, we need to do something. And I think that's a false dichotomy that we need to really pay attention to, because as Ebony said, the phone calls and emails we're getting are people who are trying to get to action and realizing they're not all on the same page. And so the role of dialogue can be really to help you get on the same page, or at least explore your differences and figure out what it is that you can collectively do together. So dialogue can be a step in getting to action, but I think we rush prematurely to that phase of trying to do something without spending the time of in dialogue. We can discover fractures and fragment ourselves before we get to any sustained actionable change. So I think that the work of dialogue practitioners is to be really thoughtful about what is the role for dialogue in the social change that you're trying to pursue. Because it is a tool, but it's not the only tool. And the temptation for those of us who love dialogue and who have been changed by a dialogue and want to bring that to others is that sometimes we start to see dialogue as the only thing that needs to be done. And it is a piece of the puzzle, but it's not the only one. So we need to be really thoughtful about our own discernment about where does it fit and when, and who are we bringing to the table and why, and doing that kind of work before we invite people around the table so that we're clear on, you know, what we're trying to achieve and how we're doing it in a way that doesn't, you know, bring harm to folks who have been experienced. You know, like Ebony said, if there's a big education gap and you bring people together, you can set up a space that is harm, does more harm than good by asking some folks to display their pain and other folks are just become voyeurs to that. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done on the discernment side beforehand of how does dialogue fit in this moment of social change.
So, Matthew, before we came on air here, we were chatting a little bit about the situation in Richmond right now. And there's Richmond, like other cities, but maybe particularly Richmond, is much in the news as the whole debate about the Confederate statues is in the headlines. And so how do you see dialogue in that context? And, you know, we sometimes say we talk often about the complexity and the ambiguity of history, right? And the need for everybody's story to be told and honored in some way. But how do we do that if the story is based on a false narrative? I mean, what's the tension there for dialogue practitioners in dealing with really difficult, complex history?
So I think, the work that Initiatives of Change did here on the Trail of Enslaved Africans. So for those of you who aren't familiar, some of the work that Initiatives of Change did in Richmond was to start acknowledging untold histories. And one of the things that needs to be done is to look at the ways in which power imbalances in our society have distorted the histories that get told. And we have to be really, really honest about that. So if we look at the monuments in Richmond that have been put up, they were part of a movement to make the slaveholding South look like a, you know, an honorable place, and to literally whitewash those sins away. And so part of the work of dialogue practitioners is to be attuned to the way those distortions and power imbalances in history have affected relationships today, and being willing to try to create containers and scenarios where that imbalance can be challenged effectively. So it's not, everything isn't on equal footing in our society, so we can't pretend that every time we get people together, everybody's knowledge, experience, and everything else is also on equal footing. So I think the work of that building and using that trail of enslaved Africans was a way to set the balance of history right and tell the stories that weren't put up in monuments, so that when we get to the dialogue, people have a deeper experience of that history beyond just the official story that the powerful folks have gotten to put in stone around our city. So I think that piece of work, that education and experience blended together, was a crucial piece of the work in Richmond to actually, I think, lay the groundwork for this moment where we're ready to have a more honest reckoning with what histories do we want to tell and memorialize.
And of course, we're dealing not just with ancient history. I mean, 100 years ago, we're dealing with history, which in many ways, a history of racism and racist policies, which continued right way through, certainly to the 1960s, 1970s, and in many ways, those policies are still impacting us. And so I'm wondering, Ebony, you know, you've got also a background in city planning and urban planning. How do you see the sort of connection between understanding that history and the kind of dialogue that needs to take place about the public policy changes that need to take place? Because in one sense, one could say removing the statues is almost the easy part. I mean, we can remove a statue, right? But how does, you know, we still have a de facto segregated school system in many places. We have concentrated poverty in our housing and so forth. So how do you look at ways to sort of connect the sort of narrative with the need to address these sort of social concerns now?
I think that, so this is 2020, it's a census year, right? So that's always a good time to reflect on where we are and where we've been and where we're going. And I think very similar to unpacking the census, y'all did the last census, initiatives of change, which basically it created a conversation about where we are. We're, you know, particularly in the city, 25% poverty. In the counties, poverty has was increasing then and has significantly increased in the past 10 years. And so I think that provides a great opportunity for that deep reflection, where we come from, where are we now, and where do we want to go based on our numbers, because you can see that change over time. But it also roots everybody in the same factual information, right? So we're not talking about your opinion or whatever, we're talking about the poverty numbers have increased in our city. Like, case in point, there's been a good amount of conversation. I did a planning, both Matthew and I worked on a regional housing plan where we're looking at housing, right? And those numbers told a story of Black home ownership decreasing, right? Not only from the Great Recession, but, and the aftermath of those foreclosures is that in our city, although our population is increasing, Black people are decreasing, and particularly Black home ownership. So in the past 10 years, there's 3,500 less Black homeowners. And so I think from a planning perspective, even, and we're redoing our master plan too, being grounded in time and how those numbers have shifted, right, could be a point of conversation. Where have we been? Where are we now? Where do we want to go together? And again, hopefully from a public policy perspective, and planning is probably a really good way to do that, because it's all rooted in community meetings, right? And so we take that data as existing conditions as a starting point, and we look back at our history, and there's been a great, I think in Richmond, probably because of the work of Initiatives of Change, grounding us in the racist history in our city, how that's created segregation, the history of displacing Black people through the highway, public housing, all those things. I think generally, professionally, a lot of folks in redlining are really rooted and grounded in that history, which gets us up to now. And then we're changing demographically. It's not Black or white anymore. We have a growing Latino population. And so I think that planning, and inherent in planning, if you do it well, is having public dialogue and hearing from all walks of the community and saying, this is where we came from, here we are now, where is it that we want to go? But also trying to, as a planner, root and ground people in equity, right? And we want, what kind of city do we want, and how do we point people there? And so you can be a voice of, hopefully sometimes, a voice of steering that a bit, right? And having people look at the whole picture of what kind of city do we wanna be? Do we wanna be a city of continued haves and have not? Look at the numbers and look at the history and engage them in a process of civic dialogue, really what it is, about where we go. And it's already a profession that's set up to do that. Not necessarily does that well all the time, to be honest. People will get tired, but at its best, it could be that. Like, I'm working on a project now, which is a bunch of vacant land from the aftermath of the highway going through Jackson Ward, right? So now is a perfect opportunity to say, how do we honor the rich African-American history that used to be here? How do we engage?
So just to clarify for our folks who may not be aware, but Jackson Ward, being the historically Black business community, which was destroyed by a highway going through, was it the mid 1950s or 60s?
Yeah, 1950s, early 1960s. And so the aftermath of that land is like just a bunch of vacant property that's left there. And so now some of the owners of that are like, oh, this is an opportunity to in time to ask, like, how do we honor that history? We've honored other histories in our city. So, and also I think sort of what Matthew is saying, how do we lift up counter narratives in our places, right? So if we have monuments to hear, whether they're coming down or not, we can also fill our environment with lots of stories of lots of people. Native Americans are usually forgotten in this narrative that's Black and white. So how can we use our environment to highlight other cultures, story, the richness that is our diversity, so you just don't have one narrative? You say, this is a place, it's complicated, and we're gonna tell all of those complicated stories when you set foot in these neighborhoods, in these buildings, in this community, in this park. And commit to telling that story as truthfully as you can. But I've talked enough. I hope I answered your question.
It's good.
I'm reflecting on this conversation as it's evolving. And one of the things that's occurring to me is we're talking about the role of dialogue, but we're also talking about the need for education. And I think one of the interesting challenges is whenever there's a power imbalance in your society, which is in almost every society around the world, some groups have power and others don't. The group that has the power tends to be the one that writes the stories and writes the histories and gets to shape the narrative. And so then when you're bringing people together across that power imbalance, you have to deal with the fact that that there is one group whose story has been told and often another group in that dialogue whose story has not. And so one of the challenges of dialogue is, how do you handle that and how do you deal with that? And so there are some ways and some instances, I think, where dialogue itself can be the undoing of that narrative, but often that's putting the work on the marginalized group to educate the folks who have been in the dominant group, which is a burden on those folks. And so I think some of the things that we do as dialogue practitioners is figure out, how can we participate in lifting up the untold stories at the same time, bringing people into dialogue so that it's not just data. I mean, data doesn't change people's hearts.
Yep.
Right? So we can tell you the statistics about poverty. We can tell you the racist policies of American history. And when that, though, is paired with people's lived experiences and stories in a dialogue setting, it brings those things to life in a way that is much harder to ignore than when you've just read some, you know, think piece in the New York Times or wherever. Mm-hmm. And so I think what we're trying to do and highlighting here is the need to pair dialogue with that kind of education around the ways in which the power imbalances might have distorted the way that we understand our community and our histories and the way things look now.
So I think one of the things that's happening, it seems to me, right now in this sort of current situation, that a lot of folks, particularly white folks, are suddenly saying, wow, you know, we've been part of this great inequality and we've never really sort of faced that fact, right? I mean, it's a sort of, the combination of the COVID situation, the economic impact, and then the issues around the killing of black men and black women too. It's suddenly a lot of folks, and they're sort of wondering what I can do, particularly white folks, I think, are wondering what can I do. Matthew, you do a lot of work in the area of unconscious bias or implicit bias. And how does that, how can this dialogue process help people to be more aware of their unconscious bias? Because we all have bias, it's part of who we are. But I think so many of us are sort of walking around completely unaware of the impact that has around us. And and you know, as a practitioner, how do you check on your own bias?
So that's a big question. So I think, unconscious bias is it's a fascinating phenomenon that it has to do with the way our brains are wired, right? And it's not a moral failing that we have these unconscious biases. It's a cognitive processing failure. It's just the way our brains are wired that we make mental shortcuts. And those mental shortcuts are about who's trustworthy and who's not. And the role of the society in which you're raised has a lot to do with how those biases get into your brain, whether you want them there or not. And so I think for me, part of the role of dialogue is there's some promising research that shows that when you are in contact with people about whom you have these unconscious biases, it can help to start to challenge that easy categorization that your brain wants to make, that, you know, X group is lazy or X group is smarter or whatever, that your brain just wants to think in those really simplistic categories because it's simpler. And so being in dialogue and being in spaces that are mixed of all the different groups that around whom you might have some biases can be really helpful to constantly challenge your brain's desire to just put people in simple categories. And then on the work of owning your own bias is really just a lifelong journey. I just read some really disturbing research that showed that the more you're aware that bias exists, the more the temptation is to see it as other people's problem and not your own. So when you become aware of this phenomenon that people are biased, the temptation and the kind of default is to see it everywhere else except for in yourself. And I think this is where Initiatives of Change particularly has a big contribution to make to this conversation around unconscious and implicit bias, is the work has to start with you. And you've got to start, the first step is recognizing that no one is exempt from having those unconscious biases, and that you need to be doing the work of constantly inquiring and making sure that your actions aren't treating people poorly based on those biases you may have inherited from the culture around you. And so it's a constant, ongoing, you know, inward searching process to make sure that the way you're treating people is based on the values that you hold and not the unconscious biases that your brain has learned.
So I guess part of what I'm hearing you saying is that for those of us who are dialogue practitioners and think we understand these things, the sort of role of humility becomes really important, because we're all on a learning journey. And to the extent that that we recognize that, we're probably going to be better equipped to do what we need to do. In the few couple of minutes that we have left, just want to ask each of you, and each of you, and I'll start with Ebony. What's the most important lesson that you have learned as a dialogue facilitator, or that you are learning, if you want to put it in the present tense? What's
I wrote that down. let me I think that we need more spaces to see each other. I think dialogue is a tool in which we can do that. I think that, so I think this is a statistic that 75% of white people in the US don't have any real contact relationships with people of color, particularly black people. So that also helps to create that gap. And there's also an empathy gap, right? So they think that racism is a political thing because they don't actually experience it, and they don't know anyone for whom that is a reality to sort of check that. So they're living in oblivion. So I think that what I have seen this past couple of weeks is that we need more spaces to be open and honest about, like, what is it like to live in America, both as a white person and as people of color, and share those experiences with trained professionals. Because I've also heard a story of that going off the rails. It's not like a DIY thing. DIY racial dialogue, do it yourself. I wouldn't recommend. So one, the need to create more spaces for which we, dialogue is one way, I don't think it's the only way, see, hear, and create like empathy for one another, and just kind of have relationships across difference, and training people so that they can engage in those conversations at work. So almost every organization that I know that my friend has worked at, they've had this kind of space of processing recent events that's going on. 75% of those went either mediocre or not so good. Maybe I've heard like two that went fairly well, which means we need to be training people that have the capacity to manage and create these spaces within organizations, and that everybody could begin to hold up a mirror, because I think a lot of time it's just the people of color that are trying to do that work. So I think that's what I see, more spaces and more folks trained with these tools, so you, when it's the appropriate time, you have people that have that tool in their toolbox to use, and you don't have to go scrambling and saying, we've never had these conversations, we don't have anybody that lead it, either you do a poor job, or you may or may not have the resources to hire, so do the work beforehand to build those skills. It can be a professional development skills, because whether it's race or just working with interpersonal conflict in general, I think, you know, we show up at work as who we are, and so we're going to bump up against each other.
Matthew.
So I want to echo everything that Ebony just said and add something that I learned from Hugh O'Doherty, who teaches the facilitation module for the Community Trust Building Fellowship, or at least did before the pandemic hit, and we had to reconfigure everything. But I remember I was visiting him up in Boston, and my stepdaughter asked him, how do you build trust with groups who don't know you when you just walk in the room and as a facilitator? And particularly, you know, he's from Northern Ireland, as a you know, white presenting man walking into rooms, and, you know, he's worked in Kenya and in Venezuela. And so she was like, how do you build trust with those folks? And his answer stuck with me since then, which was, you have to be a non-anxious presence. That groups are afraid that the conflict that they have is insurmountable, that they can't actually deal with it, that it will, you know, break their community or whatever. And he said, if you as the facilitator become anxious or scared, and don't have the capacity to sit in the conflict with them, the participants then start to feel like this is not safe. And so I think one of the things that I have learned is that, you know, communities are in pain, they're in conflict, and as a facilitator, one of the gifts that you can bring is to sit with them in that and not be anxious, and expand your own ability to sit in the discomfort that is inherent in these conversations. And so that's part of our work as facilitators, is to, again, expand our own ability to sit with the discomfort, and to stay grounded and to stay peaceful and present to it, so that hopefully we can help our communities and the people we're facilitating expand their own ability to sit through that discomfort, because you're not going to get to the other side of a conflict if you're scared of facing it.
Well, thank you both. This is a big topic. We've covered a range of aspects of it, and it's been great talking with you both. Good luck with your continued work. Thanks very much, Ebony and Matthew. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Ron.
Thanks, Ron.
Thanks, Ron.